And you mentioned Towns, and his acquisition to me represents a stark departure from the classic Tibbs's, you know, he wants a rim, a shot blocker, he wants a rim protector. Because now with Towns, they're looking to go five out here. What do you think about that change of philosophy that Tibbs is adopting here?
Well, because it works for Jalen Brunson and what he does. It now allows him to get into the paint, not have to deal with a lot of big bodies, a second big man coming to help. Because, you know, a lot of times in the old system with Isaiah, they actually started with Isaiah Lowe, and then they moved him, Isaiah Hartenstein. They moved him up to the key because he was a really good passer. He could set screens, handoffs, and stuff like that. So they started doing more with him there, which they would hope would bring the big man away from the rim. The problem is that big man can still drop and can still hover and be around to, you know, to give Brunson some trouble. Or if Mitchell Robinson's out there, he's in the dunker spot. So, you know, again, the big man is still hovering. Towns has got to pull you all the way out. It's the Kristaps Porzingis thing that the Celtics added.
Yeah.
That opened up the middle of the paint for them so they can just have great ball movement, great flow. And when they did have one-on-ones, they'd get in the paint. I think Towns brings the same element that Porzingis brought to the Celtics. And I think that's going to be where you see the most impact is on that end of the floor. The guy shoots 40% from three. He's averaged double-double in rebounding and points his whole career. So he'll help you on that end. It's obviously, and I know you mentioned it, it's going to be the other end of the floor, the defensive end that we're watching to see what kind of impact or what they might be missing with the moves that they've made, and obviously still waiting out Mitchell Robinson return.
Yeah, no question. But then I do like the fact that if and when he does return, and hopefully he does come back healthy, and you know it'll obviously take him some time to get into shape, but then they have options. Now you have options. You can go Twin Tower route with Towns and Mitch have more size on your front line, or you can go your five out, get some floor spaces, get some shooters out there, and then take it from there. So it adds another way for them to create advantages, which in this league can be tough given the talent.
Yeah, and the fact that Towns played with Gobert for a couple of years, so he's kind of got a feel for playing with a defensive big man, you know, if he moves to the four. So it's not like it would be this abrupt change for him. He's already kind of got the same idea of what it would be like if you have Mitchell Robinson out there with him. So, you know, I think it could work in some situations. And it also could work if you just have Robinson coming off the bench and giving him minutes there. You know, when that just makes you deeper, it just makes you bigger. So there's a lot of versatility with this group. That's what I see. I know there's that shock of, it wasn't, I don't even know who to say. Like, yeah, okay, so they didn't trade for Luka Doncic, right? I get it. Like, I understand. Yeah. It's a guy that he's been an all-star several times. He averages 20-10. He shoots 40% from threes, a big man. But we all, and he's had moments in the playoffs, but we also know that there's a reputation that sometimes he's a bit goofy, that maybe he's not as always locked in, that you know, he went for that 60-point game and then he was shooting threes and they almost lost the game.
Yeah.
Like, there's stuff like that that I know fans don't love, but understand this. They haven't had a big man like him. And I even go beyond Amari because, you know, Amari was undersized for a big man.
Sure.
Like, they haven't had a guy that does what he does since Patrick. You know, that's not hyperbole. That's legit. What he can do is at that level, right? Now, I know he doesn't have the ferocity of Patrick. I know he's not a defensive player like Patrick. But I mean, the elements he brings, three-point shooting, the size. The Knicks were a small team. He gives them legit seven-foot length. That's important. And look at the East. I mentioned Porzingis. He murdered the Knicks last year when the Knicks played the Celtics. They couldn't guard him. He would, those early pick-and-pop threes in those games, it was just – he was tough guard. Now they've got – a counter. And then the Embiid factor. Yes, the Knicks beat Embiid in the playoffs. Embiid had one leg. We all know. And by the way, on one leg, he still averaged 30 and 15.
He was still killing.
Now they got a guy that, A, they have some beef. B, you gotta guard him. Like, you can't sit in the paint. You got to guard him. And so that challenges Embiid a little more. That makes it harder for Embiid. When you play the Bucks, you got a guy that now Brook Lopez can't just wander around being like an extra defender.
Right.
He can't sit on the perimeter. So you've got a lineup that better fits playing against some of the best teams in the East, and a guy that has played in the West enough that he knows how to play against Jokic. He's done it. He knows how to play against some of these other teams. Anthony Davis, he's done it. So I just think it's a good fit, and I think it makes them better. And I think in time, fans will start to appreciate him once you start to see how it all unfolds. Because I know from watching Brunson in the preseason, he's quite happy having a big man like that that can open up the paint.
CP the Franchise, Alan Hahn on the ones and twos. Knicks 24-25 season preview. Salute to everybody in the chat once again. Hit the like button, hit the share button, and subscribe to the channel. If you're watching on the YouTube side, throw a solo in the chat to salute our guy, Alan Hahn. I didn't like it when I first heard it.
That's fine. That's fine. What you didn't like him, or you didn't like the trade itself? Because you knew Randall was going to be involved in a deal like that.
Two things. Didn't mind losing Julius if it was, you know, even or better return.
Yeah.
I hated losing Dante DiVincenzo. That was tough.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. When I heard that, Mitch, I thought the same thing.
Yeah, it was going to be hard to even lose Mitch. I like Mitch a lot, even personally. DiVincenzo, that was tough, man. That was tough. He really embodied this team. And
I agree.
Three-point shooting, off the bench, fire and desire, all of that. Agree. Man. He was tailor-made for us. And he showed it last week. He was not too happy about it. But I get the vision. And I said on Twitter, we can't question Leon Rose because they're clicking on all cylinders right now.
Fair point.
We can't question it. So, and even in these first couple of preseason games, you're already seeing a more fluid connection with Jalen Brunson than you've ever seen with Brunson and Randall. I was looking for that for the 2 years they were together, and it was just never really that fluid.
And it's so funny, man. It's right there, too. Even some of the passes that went awry, the two-man game that they were showing off. Right. They didn't want to show too much of it, but you could just see there's like that, like there's something there.
There's something there.
Yeah, like that's what I mean. Like I think once it evolved, I think some fans might start to – like what they're seeing offensively.
Yeah, but because we even saw that with Brunson and Ihart last year to a lesser extent. Like you saw that chemistry there. So now you're bringing in Towns. The two things that I fear, number one, like the soft label, I think everybody defines it a different way. People look at his character. He's a goofy guy. He says this, he says that. That's not it for me at all. For me, the soft it comes from, which a lot of players don't have, is that killer instinct. It's that killer instinct. Is he going to be the guy who is going to be able to mix it up when the shots aren't falling? Is he going to be the guy who picks up his fifth foul in the third quarter and he's having a meltdown? You know,
That's those things.
When people initially ask me, they're like, well, you're trading Julius for Towns. I'm like, well, to me, that's a question mark for a question mark in a big spot. What is he going to do for them in a big spot? And how does he adjust? That's what I want to see. And then secondly, I wonder, like, are they going to become a little too one-dimensional and be a little too shot happy? I don't see enough slashes on this team or a guy that's going to put his head down, get to the basket and draw some contact. That's who I would like to see Towns be if the jumper's not falling from 32 feet away. Can you go down, get to the free throw line, stop the clock, get these guys some rest, and get easier buckets? How do they generate easier buckets with these guys is what I want to see this year.
Again, spreading the floor and letting Brunson go one-on-one in the paint. He's the second best paint scoring guard in the NBA next to Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. Like, no one took more shots in the paint than he did at the guard position. He's got a higher percentage than Shai Gilgeous-Alexander in the paint. It's what he wants to do. It's where he does his best work. So having a big man that can shoot threes and pulls you away from the basket. So if your big man cheats and tries to come and help out on Brunson, Jalen knows where he's going to be, and he's going to kick it out. Like, and so you're going to probably see a high volume of threes coming from him, just like you're going to see a high volume of threes coming from OG Anunoby in that corner. I think the offense will have more flow than it did with Julius Randle, because Julius Randle, whether he meant to or not, was a stopper. And a lot of times it was the sixth dribble that got you, right? Like, when he was a two-dribble guy, he was a more efficient player. When he got to three-plus, you know, five – you know, six, and you knew, all right, now everybody's like this, like, what are we doing? Like, I don't know where he's going. Now he's going to spin. You know, I think, you know, Towns, they'll have to just make sure he doesn't do that, but I don't think he does that nearly as much. And when you're asking about, like, can he do this in a big spot, he doesn't have to. You know, like, I think there's a lot of pressure off him. And we saw in Minnesota, they went to the conference finals in the West, by the way. They won a game seven in Denver, down 20 versus the MVP. And, I mean, I watched all that. You know, Carl wasn't sitting on the bench. And he was playing. Like, he was in that, right? So he was part of that. So, yes, Anthony Edwards is the main piece, but that's the same thing here. And he said that. Brunson is the main guy. This is his team. He's the guy. I'm here to amplify. He used that word amplify, and I love that word. But he said, I'm here to amplify what he's doing. And so he understood how to do that by playing with Anthony Edwards. Now he's got Jalen Brunson. So I think it's a matter of that. If he is a piece that helps amplify more than Randle could, because, you know, for Julius Randle, he's more of a, like, you know, it's my ball. Like, he's that kind of guy. He's a primary scorer. Whereas I think Towns has developed into someone that understands the role of secondary score at a real and an elite one. So that's it for me. Now, my pause when it comes to the trade is not the soft part, but more or less the ferocity thing that for Towns is very inconsistent. And in New York, especially when you play at home, like, you can't have a night where I'm not feeling it.
Can't.
Like, my big man can't do that. And, you know, Tyson Chandler set that tone as well. Like, he had it like that. Amari would have that same kind of, you need a ferocity. And that's what I think a lot of people loved about Mitchell Robinson, is when he was healthy, he just had a motor about him that he had developed over time. And you felt like, man, that guy can get every rebound he wants, right? When he was going well, he got every rebound he wanted. And then when Hartenstein had to take over, Isaiah Hartenstein played with ferocity.
Yeah, like, he played with an edge.
He was tough. Yes, he dunked on some people. Like, he blocked some dunk attempts. You know, that's the stuff that I think Knicks centers, going back to Willis Reed, Knicks centers, when they're their best, play with ferocity. You need those guys. Otherwise, you're not winning a damn thing. Yeah. Even Marcus Camby, who's, you know, like, not as much on that level of, like, being a intimidating big man, but, like, he had some ferocity to him in those years he was here, because he got after it, blocking shots and rebounding, running the floor. So that's all you're asking for from Towns. The only consistency I need from you is your attitude every night has to be to dominate. And I saw him get 16 rebounds against Rudy Gobert last Sunday. I saw him get 16 rebounds and he cared. You know, like, they were playing. That was a preseason game, but they were getting after it. So see, that's my issue. I'm not worried about the offense. It's going to work. I'm not worried about, you know, he shot poorly in the preseason. I'm not worried. He's a 40% shooter for his career. I'm not worried. It's that consistent ferocity. Can he bring that every night, especially at home? You want to take a night off? Do it on the road. Don't do it in this building. And I hope he understands that, because if he brings that, he will be loved by Knicks fans.